So the topic was the Bastet-Serre theory, which deals with the structure of groups acting on trees. So we saw some example of groups acting on trees in particular cases, like a group acting on trees freely, or groups acting on trees with a fundamental domain, which is an interval. And we saw how we can learn about the group structure in these cases, and then we went to the general case. So the general case is that we have that G is a group acting on a tree, and from the fact it acts on the tree, we can understand its structure, and the structure is going to be the structure of a fundamental group of a graph of groups, which we defined last time. So let me just recall, very shortly, the definitions, the basic definitions. So we had a graph of groups. So a graph of groups is a pair. So it's a graph Y. And G is some grouping of Y, meaning that on this graph, every vertex gets some group attached to it. And also every edge gets some group attached to it. And also we have embeddings of this edge group into each one of the vertex groups. This is a graph of groups. Then for a graph of groups, we had the group FGY. So FGY was the group generated by, I will not write all the details, but just it is the group generated by all groups which are vertex groups. So it's like GP1, GP2, all these groups attached to vertices. So that's all groups attached to vertices. And also, so it may be infinite, right? Like this graph may be infinite, and then we have infinite even groups here. And then also we take all edges. So for each edge, we add a generator. So that's, I call it E. Okay, let's call it Y. So this is Y1, Y2. So it is generated by all groups, and each edge is also a generator in this group with the relations. Okay, so we have all the relations inside each one of these groups, and also we have the relation that going back on the edge Y is just like having Y inverse for each edge Y. And also, we have that Y, AY, Y inverse is like A, Y in the opposite direction. This means that, okay, so if you remember, so when A, so here A is an element of the edge group. So if we have an element A which belongs to this group, then we can identify it with AY, which is its image here, its image in the embedding in this group, and AY inverse, which is the embedding in this group. And we want to have the identity that if we do A here, and then we go to Y, then we do A inverse here, and we go back, this should cancel. Like it's like saying we identify the images of A in both groups. Okay, and so these are all the words we have, but then we wanted to construct a fundamental group for this graph of groups. So we don't really take all these words. We want to consider, so we had words of type C. So C, when C is a path, inside Y were our edges. So if C is some path in Y, let's say this is Y1, Y2, Y3, then a word of type C was a word of the form some element from GP, then Y1, then some element from this GQ, then Y2, then some element from GR, then Y3. So it's a world which has like a structure inside the graph, which goes along some path. So then if C is a path, then a world of type C was an element of this form. So it's P0, Y1, P1, Y2, P2, Y3, P4, say, okay, but with N, where each one of the P belongs to the vertex group, and then each one of the Ys is just, yeah, these are the elements of the path. רואים את הטוש הזה בצורה סבירה? חצי כוח. אוקיי, לא, זה סבבה. אוקיי, so that was a word of type C, and now we can define the fundamental group of the graph of groups. So, say we have a graph of groups, this is our graph of groups. So, who's gonna be its fundamental, fundamental group? And we remark that even though I'm writing here P0, it does not depend on P0, up to isomorphism. So P0 is some vertex, it belongs to. We fix the vertex inside Y. And then these are the group of all words in FGY of type that are of type C for C being, so we want, like in fundamental groups, we want that C will be a loop starting and ending at P0. For C, a loop starting and ending at P0. Okay, so if this is P0, then this is an element in Psi 1. So this is one definition of the fundamental group. So you see, it's exactly the same as a fundamental group of just a graph, but on every vertex, you can add also an element from the group. If I took all these groups to be trivial, this would be just the fundamental group. And since what I just said, it comes out that the fundamental group of this graph is a quotient of the fundamental group of the graph of groups. You just quotient by the normal group generated by all stabilizers. If you ignore all stabilizers, you just stay with the fundamental group in
Can
the
I
usual
make a
sense.
Small remark?
Yeah, sure.
Just about another reason why it might be called fundamental group is, so if for each vertex it has a topological space, and like in the edges they intersect in a path connected space, then this is how you get the fundamental group of the whole space from the part space. It's like a generalization of Seifert and van Kampen theorem.
Cool, thanks. Thanks for the round. Yeah. So in the same way, you're saying like, instead of, I can think of it as attaching a group for each vertex, but I could similarly attach a topological space for each vertex.
You can think of a vertex being a topological space, an edge,
mm-hmm.
if they intersect in a path connected way, they shouldn't intersect in a different way, and I guess also intersection should be open or something like this. Then precisely this is how you get the fundamental group of the whole space.
Great. So thank you. Let me add another remark. So in the same way that in a fundamental groups, we can think of a fundamental group in two ways. Either we fix a vertex and then we take all loops starting in this vertex, or we take a tree, we quotient by this tree, so we squeeze it, we make it a point, and then we consider just the, we will be left with a bucket of circles. So here we can also define it similarly, so just let me give the other definition because sometimes it's easier to work with. So this is definition one, and definition two, which is equivalent, is let T in Y be a maximal tree. Then we can define pi one of this of this graph of groups with respect to T. So this will be just the quotient quotient of this group FGY, which we defined before, by the normal subgroup generated by the elements y inside the edges of T. So another way to think about this fundamental group, which is sometimes easier, is you take all these elements, but inside this graph you take a maximal tree, say this, and then you want to imagine that we are modding by this tree and makes it one point. So making it one point will be just like saying that walking along these edges is trivial. So we just make all this, we make one y1, y3, and I don't know, say this is 1, 5, we make all of them trivial. So we are left with this is y2 and y4. And here now when we have this point, we think of this point as being all this tree. So it means that here, the group that is attached here, you can think of it as being the amalgamated product of all these groups, GP, GQ, GR, and this G. Because like all of them are kind of the words we have, if we ignore these Ys, we have the group generated by all these vertices. All these groups vertices. Okay.
Did you define last time H and N also?
No, I did not. It was one of my examples, but
So just a remark, if you get to see this, so we have the two pieces out of which we construct this graph of groups concept. One piece is an edge that we have seen before. The graph of groups given, if the graph is an edge, is just an amalgamated product. And one other basic piece is what about just one vertex and one loop? And basically you have the definition if you specialize, but you should know that this concept appeared much before, the concept of a graph of groups, and it's called H and N extension.
But it's not precise. In the amalgamated product, there was a group attached to the edge. In this definition, there is no group attached to the edge, just to the vertices. And if I understand correctly, here, if you take a graph, whatever graph you take, and the group at each vertex is a trivial group, you will not get a fundamental group of the graph, you will get a trivial group. So...
I divide only by the y's which belongs to T. So in this example, I don't divide by this. Okay. Yeah, this will stay non-trivial, okay. So here I will get F2 if all groups are trivial.
Okay. I guess the H and N extension classically is something where the edge group is just Z, and you have two identification of two elements in the vertex group. I mean, but you have the definition, you don't need to think about it. Just if you see this H and N, you should know that this is a special case of a graph of groups.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So it's the only special, like we did the two of the three special cases and skipped the H and N. But if we have time, we'll do it in the end. So these are the definitions we need to recall from last time, and last time we just stated the theorem, so let me state it again and give some examples of it. So what we want to have is just using this definition of pi 1, we want to
just one more. Like, if you want to get the amalgamated product in this form, it's not just one edge, it's two edge and a group in the middle. So there is
you do have a group attached to each edge.
Here? Yeah. No.
Yes.
Yeah.
G1.
I have GY here, but Tzachik is right in the sense that when I consider FGY, I don't care about, it's not that I don't care about these GYs, but I'm not using them. I'm just using them in the sense that each GY has a copy of it, sits inside, like each GY embeds inside GQ and GP. But I don't like add them. I when I walking along one of the edges, I just take the element y, like I call this edge an element in the group, and that's it, it's one element. Okay. So how is this related to groups acting on a tree? So now let me state the so let me run and bring the page that I missed. Let me do the setting, because like it's a long setting and then a short theorem. So let G be a group. Acting on a tree X without inversions. Okay, and we show that what we are going to show is that G can be identified with the fundamental group of some graph of groups. Well, what is this graph of groups? So it's very easy to see what is Y. Y is just going to be the quotient of the tree X on which G is acting by G, so this is going to be Y. And now we will construct the grouping, like we will attach, so this say this is Y. And now we will construct how to, like the grouping, how to attach a group to each vertex such that G will really be identified with this graph. So, so now we will constructing we will construct this graph of groups. So the way we construct it is as follows, maybe parallel to the construction I will do an example. Oh, okay, I will write the details of the construction and then we will view some examples. So the construction is as follows. First, we take, so we have y is just the quotient. After we have y, we are going to take a maximal tree. So the idea is just that to each vertex we want to attach its stabilizer inside G. But you know, this is not really a subset of X, this is a quotient of X. So we want to kind of lift it to a sub tree or a sub graph of X. We cannot really do it because X is a tree, so it doesn't really admit Y as a sub graph. Y does not need to be a tree. But we will lift, for beginning, a maximal tree of Y into a sub tree of X. Then we will kind of, you know, close the surrounding edges. So we start by taking T, a maximal tree. Yeah, so X was here.
In Y, I suppose.
Right, thank you, in Y. So X is here, X is a tree. Then you have Y, which is the quotient. So I'm taking a maximal tree here. Then for beginning, I'm lifting this maximal tree. So let J from T to X be a lifting. So this is just like choosing, you know, some three vertices and three edges which map onto this in the quotient map. So let's say it was this. Okay, after I'm choosing a lifting,
just,
I want to...
Just to make the remark that because the tree is connected, and simply connected, you just need to lift one vertex, and the lift is guaranteed by this.
And yeah, so what you're saying is that it's always possible to choose the lift such that it will really be a sub-tree, right?
Yes.
Yeah, and not just, you know, three distinct vertices without edges. So, yeah. So we choose a lifting of T, and now we want to extend it. So we have, you know, now by this lifting, we know how to identify each one of these vertices with them. But what we are missing is how to identify the other edges. So we extend. Extend J to a section. To a section going from EY. So far it was only from ET, but now we want to extend it to a section from EY to EX, to the edges of X. And we want to do it in a way that makes sense. So what does it mean that it makes sense? That J of a Y backward will be just like doing JY backward. So, you know, this is if you consider the orientation. It just, okay.
Can you explain it again? Sorry.
Yeah, because we think of each edge, I'm just drawing it as an edge, but actually we have also all edges here are oriented, and then and each edge has two edges. So this edge is actually, you know, y, which is going to this direction, and then y bar, which is going to this direction. And when I extend j, and also when I lift j on the beginning, but also when I extend j, if I choose to send this y, say, here, does it make sense? Yeah, let's say this was this vertex. So jy is going like this, then I want to send y bar into, you know, I want that jy bar will be the inverse of the other direction, the bar of jy. So this JY bar is just like doing JY bar. Yeah. So it's just, I'm doing it in a way that makes sense. There is nothing here more than that. And if you want to choose it, then you can always choose it such that O, saying that the origin of JY will be J of OY. So this is just a way of how, so an algorithm of how to choose the lifting. So I have JY. How will I decide where JY will start? I will start it like I want the origin of the lifting of Y to be the lifting of the origin of Y. So say this is Y, and this is the origin of Y. And this is the end of y. So the j of oy, let me do it the other way, just because this is how I painted it, how I draw it. So if this is the beginning of y and this is the end of y, then I choose to send, so j of oy is this vertex, this is j of oy. This is the lifting of this vertex, of this red vertex. And I'm sending y such that it will begin in the beginning in this. So we'll go, say, here. Okay, but this is just to say that I'm extending the lifting in a way that makes sense, such that now not only that I have a lifting of the tree, I have also a lifting of all the rest of the edges of my graph. Okay, and now last thing I'm doing, last preparation, is that for every y that was in y, that was an edge in y, or let's start by the ones that were edges only in y but not in t. So for every y of this like extra edges, I want to attach an element of the group G, which it will be useful for us. Okay, we are now constructing GY, the graph of groups. Then we will want to show that there is an isomorphism between the fundamental group of this and G. So now what I'm preparing is like this edge, what's going to be its image inside G. So I'm now preparing for each edge, I'm preparing an element in G to which it's going to be sent. So for every y inside the edges of y without t, I'm going to choose a vertex, not a vertex, an element in G, which will be called gamma y. And it is going to be defined by, so I'm choosing an element inside G, such that the end of JY is gamma y J T Y. What does this mean? So T of J Y, so this, say this is Y. It's our red edge going here. J Y is this red edge going to this direction. And now I know that, so this is JY. JY starts here and ends here. So this is T of JY, it's the end of JY. Now, T of JY, as you see, it's not already part of the lifting of the graph Y. So the vertices of the graph Y, these four vertices, were lifted to these four vertices. So this is already in a different copy of, it's in some translation of this spanning tree T. So, since it's in some translation, there exists some element inside G. There exists some element inside G.
Maybe add upstairs J of T Y.
So I will draw J of T Y. So T Y, so this was Y. This is O of Y, this is T of Y. So J of T Y is a, is it? Okay, it's someone, right? It's one of the other vertices. So it's one of these, if these four vertices, 1, 2, 3, 4, were mapped into 1, 2, 3, 4, tilde. So these are each one of the lifting of these vertices. Then J of TY, so it's J of number 4, so it is this one. This is... Here this is J of T Y. Okay, now since J of T Y is inside T, and this is inside the translation of T, there exists an element of G moving this into that. Okay, I need to say something else. Not only that they are in different translations of T, but also they both map into the same vertex, which means that there is an element of G moving between them. So there is an element of G sending this to this. This is the element of G that I'm choosing. Maybe I said it the other way. I want an element of T moving JT of Y to TJ of Y. So I want an element of G moving this vertex here. There exists such. I'm choosing it to be gamma Y. So this is to take any edge and send it to some element of G. And also this was defined only for edges which are not in the spanning tree. Inside the spanning tree, so
no, I'm just saying, so like for elements in T, it's as if you choose gamma y to be trivial, right?
Exactly. So this is exactly. So this is what I'm going to say. So if I, so for y which is already an edge of T, it doesn't make sense to ask it, because you know gamma G does not move between elements inside T, right? Because T is a fundamental domain. So for Y, for elements Y which are inside ET, I'm just taking gamma Y to be trivial. Okay, so we are done with the preparations. And now, let me summarize and say what is our graph of groups. So now we attach to each vertex, P inside Y. So P is a vertex inside Y. Attach the group G P tilde. So or G J P in our notation. So it's the stabilizer inside G of the lifting of P. yeah, my tildes were all like lifting off. This I also denote by two tildes. Okay, this is for every vertex, and to each, okay, this is to every vertex, and to each edge, z, say in y, I attach the same thing, the stabilizer inside the g of the lifting of this edge. So I'm just, so this graph is going to be a graph, this graph of groups is going to be just the graph of groups of stabilizers. All this construction was just to say exactly how do I choose the stabilizer for every vertex. So, so now let's state the theorem.
No, maybe you still need the inclusions of the edge groups inside the vertex groups, which you didn't specify.
I didn't specify it, but... Ah, right. You are right. So when I'm saying who is the graph of groups, I need to define the groups on the vertices, the groups on the edges, and you're right that I also need to say what are the embeddings. So the embeddings are just embeddings.
Yeah.
So the embeddings are just G, J, Z is embedded inside G, J, P as if. Is embedded in the as subgroups of G, as a subgroup of G. Yeah.
That would be for the edges of the tree.
Right.
But for the edges, I suppose that for the edges that of.
Also for the edges not in the tree, I still have.
You won't use this conjugation by gammas.
I mean
that's why you constructed them.
So I need to conjugate it by gamma, something like that.
For the wrong side. I mean.
You're right. So I didn't write it down. So I don't want to like so I did write it down. Okay. So you're right. So let me add this. So what are my embeddings? So it will be that G. Right. So let me add this. So G Y. So the embeddings are going to be that G of an edge g of an edge z is gonna be embedded inside the end of the edge z. So this is for both directions because you know you can also take z bar and embed it in tz bar by a is sent to a y, which is a gamma y inverse, or maybe the other direction, like it depends by the orientation. But so each edge will have either this or the inverse. So what we said is that if we have edges which are inside T, then we can just indeed, you know, they are embedded, this edge is embedded in the group of this and in the group of this. But this edge is somehow, if I go up to the tree, then my beginning vertex is this, but my ending vertex is this. It's not this, it's not another one in the tree. So this way I need to conjugate it by this element to really get the right embedding of this edge inside the group, the stabilizer of this, which is a conjugate of the stabilizer of my of its friend inside the spanning tree. Okay, I hope you can. Okay, I hope we still observe the large picture after all the small details, so you can enjoy the theorem, which is super nice.
Gamma y's are somehow compatible, or you can just choose them when.
What is compatible?
The gamma y's, don't you want them?
I just want them to satisfy the fact that they. That they translate what's written here. So the theorem is the following. Let G be a group acting on a tree X without inversion. That's our settings all the time. define g of y as we did with all the details, then we have that g is isomorphic to the fundamental group of g yt for where t and everything is just what we did in the construction. So this is the theorem. And okay, so it's not a proof, but it's like what is being done in the proof. So let me tell you who is the isomorphism, and that's kind of like the only thing possible, the only thing that makes sense. So the isomorphism is, so we denote it by phi. So the isomorphism, so when I'm saying, so elements here are defined by elements of F, GY. So it's enough to say, so this homomorphism is defined by or induced by the inclusions of all the vertex, all the vertex stabilizers inside G, where P is a vertex in Y. And by sending each gy, each element y to gamma y. Yeah. So elements here, if you remember, this is a quotient of what we called fgy, and inside fgy we had fgy was generated by these groups, these vertex groups. So when you have something from this vertex group, you just embed it in G. And when you have a Y, you send it to this gamma Y that we defined. So this is just the isomorphism. Okay, so now let's go for the fun part and observe like one or two definitions. And then I want to show you an application. So I hope we'll have time for everything. You have questions about the statement?
I have a remark, maybe. A priori, for the construction of pi 1 depends on a base point.
So there is a lemma that not only that for every base point, this is isomorphic to a spanning tree, and then it shows that it does not depend neither on the choice of a spanning tree or on the choice of a base point. Yeah. The proof goes very similar to the one we know from just the fundamental groups in the graph case. Okay, so example one. So I will take just a tree that we know and the group that we know that acts on it, and so I'm considering just what I'm drawing here is a four regular tree, and if I'm identifying it with the Cayley graph of F2, then I can consider the action of the group. So I want the group generated by a cubed and b, but I'm taking its normalizer just to, and not the normalizer, the normal subgroup generated by this, and I want to understand it in the sense of a graph of groups. So this is acting here, for example, a3 sends this point, which is e, to a cubed a3 sends it here. Okay, like not to a and a cubed, it sends it here. Okay, so let me draw Y. So inside Y, okay, I have this E. I have, oh, it's not E, right? But I'm in the quotient, this vertex, and this vertex, you cannot get between them, so it's like three disjoint distinct vertices. But A3 is already identified with E, so this kind of interval. I can think of it as being here. And then I can, and this vertex is already identified with E by the element B. So I have a loop here. And also, since, you know, I'm taking this with the, I'm taking the all the conjugates of these elements. So I can also get from A to AB. So this is also identified with this vertex, and this is identified with this vertex. So my quotient graph looks like that. So this is Y. This is the graph, is it? This is Y, and it's X mod G.
Yeah. When you draw the quotient graph, it should be for regular, right? Like the graph. Yeah.
Because in this case we have no stabilizers.
Yeah.
If you have stabilizers, so then you can leave this vertex in place and move this edge to this edge, and then the regularity will decrease. But if you don't have stabilizers, then the regularity is not is preserved. Okay, so now what am I doing? I'm choosing first. I'm choosing a spanning tree, so you know it makes sense somehow to choose this. I'm lifting it to a spanning tree here, so it's natural to lift it to this spanning tree. But I could to this tree, but I could choose anything else. So if this is like P Q R, this will be like J P J Q J R. Then I'm lifting also, so these edges, it's clear where they are sent. So this is like E1, E2, it's sent here. GE1, GE2, JE1, JE2. I'm not writing the orientation, but it's clear. And also I need to choose where to send each one of these edges. So let's do it for one of them, maybe. So this edge, if I'm calling it, okay, in my notation it was y4, so let's stick with it so I will not get confused. So this is y4, say it goes to this direction. Then I want that the lifting of y4 will start in the lifting of, the lifting of the edge y4 will start where the lifting of R is. So the lifting of R is here, so the lifting of AY4 is somewhere here. The beginning of it is here. So this, we can choose this to be J of Y4. So this is the lifting of Y4, and you see that it ends in some A3. Okay, and now, how do I define gamma of Y4? And similarly, I lift also these three edges. It would make sense to lift them to these three edges. Each one of them, and one I want. Now I want to choose for each edge. So, for example, for y4, I want to choose an element in G. So,
wait, I just want to remark that you don't choose the lifts now. They are forced on you because I mean
because of this beginning point. You're right.
And the fact that there are no stabilizers. So when you lift y4. The endpoint should be another lift of P.
Of P.
Not
right.
JP, but another. So
another. It for sure it will be not exactly JP, but another but another point. And the only one out of these neighbors of R is this. This is the only one which is another lift of P. And now how do I choose gamma, the element? So I want to send Y4 to some element of G. This should be an element of G. So which element of G it's gonna be? So I want an element which, so this JY4 ends at A3, and as we said, A3 is another lifting of the point P. So here is one lifting of P, this is another. So we want an element of G that moves JP into this. And we know what it is, it's A3. A3 is an element of G moving JP, which is E, to A3. So gamma y4 is an element moving A, E to A3, which is actually the element A3 inside it. And similarly, we choose the gamma y1 is going to be B, gamma y2 is going to be AB, A inverse, and gamma y3 is going to be A square B, A minus 2. Because these are the elements moving this vertex here, this vertex here, and this vertex here, which are all liftings of, like, it's two liftings of this, two liftings of this, and two liftings of this. Okay, so this is our y, and now what's going to be our g? So g, now, okay, we know what is g, but we want to identify it. So it will be identified with, g will be identified with pi 1 of this thing. Okay, this is the graph, and the grouping is, you know, p gets the stabilizer of this vertex, q the stabilizer of this, r the stabilizer of this. And as we said before, each edge is mapped to this element. Now, so let me just, when we are saying a graph of groups, so we are saying, like, we have the graph of groups, we have the graph itself, which we just did, and the 3T. So when we, so since here we have no stabilizer, then the groups attached to P, to Q, and to R are going to be trivial. And then when we take the fundamental group, we squeeze along this tree. Each tree of them becomes a point. And this point, when you choose an element from it, it's just a trivial element because these groups are trivial. So what we will get is that this will be just this will be just the fundamental group of, so now I'm drawing it after I squeeze it along, I made all these three to be one point, and I'm only left with these three circles. This circle I'm identifying with three, with four, because I have also this circle, with four circles. This circle I'm identifying with B, this one with AB, A inverse, this one with AB, A square B, A minus 2, and this one with A3. So what I'm getting is just the free group generated by all these four elements. So this group that I got, so actually my G is a free group with four over the basis of four generators, which are these four elements. This is the particular case in which we have no stabilizers, and then we said, like, on the beginning that a group acting freely on a tree, so it's a subgroup of the tree, in this case it's a subgroup of the free group, is always free. Okay, I don't know if I should do one more example or I should just go for the results, for like an application.
Maybe a break.
Ah, but after the break...
we have a break at 12:30, so...
Today I'm doing like half, and then Ido is continuing.
I'm not sure Ido will do it.
So do you want a very short break, like 5 minutes? Because at 12:30 we are... we can do a very short break, and then we have like half an hour just saying a nice application, and maybe it will be even less than half an hour.
Okay. We can do the clapping at the end of the break.
We cannot do the clapping, no?
Always back, so...